Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Slave Trade by Craig Martelle and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Chloe Cannon. Chapter 1. Corran, Slave Pits.
Go fuck yourself!
She spat blood for emphasis. The Corranite threw his head back and laughed. When he finished, he fixed her with an intense glare. The captive was still furious. He turned, swinging one last time, knowing that it would do the trick. The sickening crunch was followed by the sound of a body hitting the deck. He glanced down to ensure she was unconscious.
When you wake up, we'll talk again,
the fibrous alien promised.
Or I'll talk, and you'll get sold, which is how it's going to end up no matter what.
He spat a yellow glob on her leg.
That's a reminder to remember your place.
Federation Border Station 7. Varid fired the railgun at the target bounding back and forth at the edge of his vision. Lindy fired and laughed as the disc disintegrated when her stream of hypervelocity projectiles ripped through it.
I used to be better at this.
Red groused through a half smile.
If you're letting me win, I'll kick your ass upside down and sideways.
She kept her railgun pointed into space while standing with a fist pressed to her hip.
Did I let you hit your targets? Is that some mind trick that I'm unaware of? If so, I need to do more of it to keep the foreplay talk coming.
He winked at her. She kicked at him, but he easily dodged the half-hearted attempt.
I may just kick your ass for the greater good of the whole galaxy.
With a nod, they agreed to stow their weapons and call it a day. The hangar bay was empty at that time of morning. Peacekeeper was anchored to the deck behind them, and a force field across the broad opening that led to space kept the atmosphere in. Their target practice had used the emptiness as their backstop. The railgun projectiles would eventually stop moving. Until then, there was a designated no-fly zone in a cone away from the station. It was nice to know lawyers who could do the paperwork to jump through those bureaucratic hoops. Until Rivka presented Red with the bill for the no-fly zone marker buoys. He almost had to sell his yacht to pay for them, but Ankh arranged a loan.
It chaps my ass that I owe him credits,
Red complained.
Why? We get to keep the yacht, even though most of our pay goes to its required maintenance and upkeep. Maybe you should rent it to people? I heard the magistrate talk about some of her investments. Let your money make money, and if you don't have money, let your property earn money while you're not using it.
Then I could pay off our little friend that much sooner.
Red rubbed his face, and Lindy wrapped an arm around his waist.
What would you do without me?
Be bored. Lonely. Probably beg the magistrate for more dangerous missions. Beat the shit out of bad guys. Yeah, that one. Beating the shit out of bad guys is a favorite way to expend excess energy in an otherwise meaningless existence.
The smirk on Lindy's face suggested she didn't agree. She stopped as their data pads vibrated at the same time.
Saved by the bill,
Red mumbled.
Saved by the magistrate's impeccable timing, more like.
They scanned the message. All hands are recalled. We're leaving on our next case as soon as I get back to the ship.
Do we have time for pizza?
Red asked, waggling his eyebrows at Lindy.
That's the first thing you think of?
What's the case? Lindy wondered, watching Red tap furiously on his data pad.
I'm worried. Usually the magistrate explains more. Calls a meeting, we all chat, then we go. Something has her spooked. Plus, we've only been back for 4 days. We were supposed to get 3 weeks off. Are you listening to me?
The magistrate can have some, too. I ordered one of those gross moonstalkle things for her. We better hurry to the ship,
Red said. Lindy rotated at the waist and drove her fist into his chest. It thudded against something hard. She yowled in pain.
What the hell do you have in your vest?
What the hell are you punching me for?
Red shot back, screwing up his face at her pain and anger.
Damn it, I'm sorry.
He dropped to a knee to get a better look at her hand. He grimaced, but quickly tried to cover it with a smile.
It's not as broken as it could be.
He sounded as hopeful and upbeat as he could.
At least it's throbbing less.
Lindy tucked her injured hand against her stomach, and with her good hand, tapped Red's chest, undid the pouch, and pulled out a spare magazine for the railgun.
You brought extra ammo? Planning on missing a lot of the targets?
It's contingency stuff. The magistrate keeps me on my toes. I can't risk failing her, which means everywhere I go, I have my gear. At least, most of it.
Lindy turned to the ship. They hadn't been more than 50 meters from it. There would have been time to return for any equipment they needed. At least, that's what she had thought.
You don't think we would have had time to go to the ship?
No,
Red replied simply.
Just like the magistrate doesn't hesitate when it's time to deliver justice, I can't hesitate when it's time to protect her. I can't leave her ass hanging out in the wind, and I won't leave yours either. If someone came through that door,
Red pointed at the far wall,
they could cut me off from the ship, but I'd still be able to fight from cover there and over there until I could get to them and finish them.
Lindy nodded slowly.
I'm sorry I let you down.
How so?
By not being as ready as you?
Red threw his head back and laughed.
Huh. I was ready for both of us. I have 2 spare magazines and extra water. Even an extra food bar.
She pulled his face to hers for a fierce kiss, before whispering,
I'm still mad at you.
What did I do now?
You weren't listening to me. And then you changed the subject.
Magistrate explains. We chat. But this time we're rushing off without knowing. I heard you just fine, but it's all speculation. And I don't like to speculate. How about we return to the ship, clean our weapons, and ask her when she arrives?
I'm still mad at you.
All hands are recalled. We're leaving on our next case as soon as I get back to the ship. Rivka watched the message go. She wasn't sure how much longer the prep work with Granger would take, but she knew they'd be leaving soon. The initial case brief had her blood boiling. Granger and Rivka were side by side in the magistrate's conference room. Together, they glared at the images on the screen.
Slavery is legal on Corran,
Rivka spat, distaste permeating her words. Her face contorted as she spoke.
How is that possible? This is the Federation.
Corran isn't in the Federation. Yet, that is. We're close to bringing him on board, but until then, they can conduct business as they wish, since they're still an independent planet. But,
he paused for effect and raised one finger,
they are on the border of Federation territory, and no one can transit Federation space with slaves.
Then how in the holy fuck are they still in business?
Slavers. The worst humanity has to offer is nothing compared to the Corranites. You need to find and cut their supply chain. Catch every Federation citizen involved and charge them. Justice needs to come swift and heavy.
Rivka spoke through clenched teeth.
And if I have to knock a few Corranite heads?
Please don't.
Granger looked at his lap.
They have something or other that is necessary for both the miniaturized power supplies and the small gate engines. The Federation is keen on sealing a long-term deal. You have to walk on eggshells where the Corranites are concerned.
After you said they were worse than any human slaver, you tell me to play nice with them? My fist is going to land squarely in their slaver faces if they don't tread lightly around me,
Rivka declared. She stood and started to pace. I have to turn a blind eye to the injustice in front of me to find the injustice behind me? Jurisdictional issues. What does a visa and access to Corran grant? She tapped her data pad.
Chaz, start taking notes, please.
She walked back and forth but didn't say anything further. Her forehead wrinkled with dismay, creating a single brow above a dark scowl. Granger crossed his arms and leaned back in his chair, tilting his head one way and then the other, as if the changed angles would show him a different side of Magistrate Rivka Anoa.
Corran law and protection of non-citizens. Everything the Federation has in regards to human and alien trafficking, kidnapping and detention of sentient species, cross-border transfers as they relate to Federation space.
Rivka recited the areas of law she wanted Chaz to research.
Is this shithole in the Corhen cluster?
How did you guess?
Granger asked, his voice neutral because it wasn't a surprise that she had guessed.
Fucking Morinvale was as much of the cluster as I wanted to see. What is the continued influence of the Mandolin partnership out there? If I remember correctly, at least one ship of the pirate fleet escaped. I'm sure we'll find that bastard again.
Maybe they've discovered the error of their ways, and now they're playing the trade routes as mobile pet washers.
Rivka nodded for a moment, but stopped and glared at Granger.
What are the chances of that?
Pet washing? Fairly low, I suspect.
She groaned and clenched her hands into fists before continuing.
There's no way they aren't doing their thing. Their fleet will have grown, but not by much. We'll have to deal with maybe 3 or 4 ships.
On a serious side note, you'll need to get approval before asking the bad company for help. General Reynolds and Nathan Lowell need to be on the same page before Terry Henry Walton's force can be brought to bear.
Rivka crossed her arms and tipped her head back to examine the senior magistrate.
Have you become a bureaucrat, Liebchen?
I have no ass left because I allowed the redeployment of strategic assets. The bad company's budget is tied to paying gigs. They aren't covered out of Federation funds. They are also expensive, orders of magnitude higher than what we spend. And they aren't a Federation asset as far as the common woman knows. Therefore, we can't pay for them unless there is a compelling need. And next time, it won't be just my ass that they chew up and hand back to me. It'll be my head. You know where shit rolls.
Downhill, right to me. But it was a massive failure on the Federation's part to allow things to get so bad that one little trigger sent an entire planet over the brink into civil war.
I don't buy it. Granger started to laugh and leaned forward to hunch over the conference table.
We'll all be buying it,
he finally managed to say.
We can get their approval in short order, or at least approval for some kind of asset. Your corvette is tough, but it's not made to go up against a major warship of any sort. With the recruitment of the Harborians and their poor performance against the destroyer, they need more active deployments to earn their chips. Warax is off the table, unless Lance Reynolds and Nathan Lowell jointly approve.
Even if Terry's wombat is with us?
That's a completely different issue. He wants to come for a visit. Hey, are you trying to find a loophole in your instructions?
I am a lawyer,
Rivka started, but stopped when Granger raised a hand.
You know the intent of your guidance. Don't make me take your ship and Red's yacht away and sell them to pay your debt to the bad company. If they aren't somewhere else doing their job, they're not getting paid. And don't blame them. You know Terry and Char would do anything for one of the good guys. And for some unholy reason, they've awarded you that title. Don't fucking do it.
Rivka flopped into the chair opposite Granger.
This one already has me twisted into a knot. My first instinct is that the entire planet of Corran needs to be purged by fire.
It's because you care, Rivka. Because you can't stand to see the injustices of the universe put on display. Because one planet believes it's okay to trade in sentient creatures. If you lose your ability to look at these things dispassionately, you become both ineffective and a loose cannon. We can't have either of those. You will be the best of us, and someday you'll be sitting in this chair talking to other magistrates about how to enforce the law, how to deliver justice, and how to do it without losing yourself in the process.
He fixed her with his clear blue eyes.
You call me if you start going off the rails. Bo is in touch with Chaz, so I should have a heads up, but don't lose it out there. Your crew is counting on you. I'm counting on you.
which means the entire Federation legal system needs you to do the right thing from a sound foundation based in the law. If you could do that while taking out McKestrey and Catwillis, then you can do that anywhere. Those guys left a huge trail of breadcrumbs, as will the slavers. Some are legitimate, as horrible as that sounds. Leave those alone. But the ones that aren't, they need to be brought up to speed. Right damn now. The illegitimate slavers will suffer mightily, and will be the case law for future transgressors. I know Bethany Ann set the precedent with her anti-slaving stance, but Federation law isn't cut and dried that it's a capital crime. I want it to be punishable by death. Granger stood and put on his magistrate's jacket, then nodded and turned to the door. He stopped to say something quietly over his shoulder. I've heard that depriving someone of their life, even if they aren't dead, can be equated to capital murder. He opened the door and walked out. Rivka accessed her datapad and tapped briefly. I'm on my way. She sent the message and stuffed the pad into the inside pocket of her jacket, then adjusted the magistrate pin on her collar and headed out. Chapter 2. Rivka stalked across the hangar deck, passing the all-guns-blazing delivery guy on his way out. She started to shake her head. Before reaching the ship, she saw Red waving at her from the open hatch.
All present and accounted for, Magistrate,
he declared. Don't tell me you ordered food. She hurried up the ramp and once inside, mashed the big red button to seal the ship.
Okay, I won't tell you.
Red shrugged and lumbered down the short passageway, turned at the open hatch to the bridge, and entered the ship's main space. It was a combination of recreation room, workout room, meeting room, and dining area.
Can't go on a mission with an empty stomach, Magistrate.
The smell of pizza reminded her how hungry she was, even though she didn't think it had been that long since she last ate. Red pointed at one of the boxes. Moonstockle?
Yes, I refuse to touch it,
he said, making a show of pulling two boxes out from underneath the magistrate's pie. Jay strolled in, still in her pajamas. She yawned, unable to cover her mouth, since her arms were filled with wombat.
Yeah!
Floyd cheered when she saw that everyone was back. Lindy scratched behind her ears, and Rivka stopped reaching for a slice and paid attention to Floyd for a few moments.
What's everyone doing?
We're getting ready to fly. Judging by the magistrate's expression, there are asses somewhere that need kicking.
Red stuffed an entire slice into his mouth so he wouldn't be asked to explain further. Lindy helped herself, elbowing Red out of the way.
I love pizza for breakfast.
Jay set Floyd on the deck and worked her way into the fray.
What time is it?
Chaz, can you ask Ankh to come out here, please?
Rivka interrupted. She turned to Jay. It's lunchtime. Ankh's door flew open and he stormed out, as much a meter-tall alien with an oversized head could storm.
I don't have time for this,
he declared, crossing his arms and glaring up at Rivka.
I respect your time, Ankh. I'll make this quick.
She put her slice down, picking off two pieces of the alien version of pineapple and eating them.
There are slave traders operating on the planet Corran in the Corhan cluster. Slaving is legal on Corran since they aren't a Federation signatory. But there's a lot of illegal trading going on by persons who are subject to Federation laws. We're going to find those who are selling people, and we're going to stop them.
Lindy stopped chewing and stared at the mural on the bulkhead. There was a section with a sun shining on a verdant planet with people enjoying themselves. 5, plus a cat and a wombat. Red ate another slice, but without the show this time. Jay stopped mid-reach.
There are people who sell other people?
There are races where it's okay to do that. But Corran is close to joining the Federation. Maybe we'll get lucky and help them close down their meat markets.
Ankh started tapping his foot, and Rivka stared at it until he stopped. I hear they have Krenelian slaves.
Rivka taunted.
We make lousy slaves, he replied. But I agree that this practice needs to end. Let Erasmus and me know when we're close. I assume you don't have a plan.
Rivka's mouth opened and closed, and she stammered, but they weren't words.
The usual.
Ankh returned to his room and closed the door.
It chaps my ass that I owe him money,
Red whispered to Lindy.
But he's not wrong.
Rivka stepped forward until she was chest to chest with Varad. Carefully, he reached around her and snagged another slice of pizza. He took a slow bite, his eyes fixed on hers.
Are we that bad?
Rivka finally asked.
Don't answer that. We always have a loose plan that gets refined as we gather more information and build our case. And then we formulate a clear takedown strategy on the perps before delivering justice.
That's how I see it,
Red said through a mouthful of hot pizza.
You left out the explosions, the blood, and the running, but everything else is right.
Jay recovered sufficiently to share a slice with Floyd. Rivka turned to Lindy, looking for support. Lindy obliged her.
Your job cannot be relegated to a diagram of steps from start to finish. You deal with more unknowns than an engineer like Ankh. He can't write a program without knowing the steps it must follow. He cannot address variables if he doesn't know their parameters. I think we have a challenging job, but you give us the best chance of success. I haven't been on all the missions, but Red and Jay have. You've never failed, Magistrate. That's the team I like being on.
I agree, Jay mumbled, swallowing before she continued. It's like my old home. Say we arrive on a space station and don't know where to go for a meal. We ask around until we find a restaurant, but they don't serve anything good. We find a different restaurant, but they serve spoiled food. The magistrate shuts them down, but we keep going because we're still hungry. We haven't achieved what we went there for. We find someone getting mugged, and of course we stop that. Then we finally find the good restaurant, but they're closed until dinner. So we have to cool our heels, and we're not good at waiting.
So we break in and make our own dinner,
Red finished for her.
We don't break in,
Rivka corrected. Red raised one eyebrow.
Often.
Slave trade. Sounds like I'm going to need a shower after just talking about it.
Lindy's lip curled. The ship lifted off and carefully maneuvered into open space.
Magistrate, may I have the coordinates where we are going?
Chaz asked.
Back to the Corran cluster, Chaz. Planet Corran.
Do you want to arrive close to the planet?
I don't think so. Let's shoot for the edge of the heliosphere and get the lay of the land. I need to do a great deal of research before we storm the castle walls.
We'll gate momentarily to the edge of the heliosphere. No one will know we've arrived until you want to make your presence known.
I like the way you think, Chaz. Consolidate the information I asked you to pull, and prepare to gate, on my order.
Standing by, Magistrate.
I help!
Floyd cried, scratching at the table.
Why are you so upset, little girl?
Jay wondered, stroking the wombat's fur to calm her.
My friends are angry and sad,
Floyd explained.
Just for now, Floyd,
Red said as he continued to eat. Lindy closed the lid on the second box to cut him off. He smirked at her.
We're going to save a lot of people from the fate of being owned by someone else.
It's all I know,
Floyd said slowly. Jay hugged the furry beast.
You're free, Floyd.
I'm loved,
the wombat corrected.
I can't be free. I would die. I grew up with slaves on a planet far away. Terry saved me. Saved all of us.
Yes, he did, Rivka agreed. You're our friend, Floyd. If you need anything, we will move mountains to make sure you get it.
Unless you keep eating my pizza,
Red grumbled.
Give her your fucking pizza, you monster.
Rivka pounded the table for emphasis. Without hesitation, Red put the slice in front of Floyd's face. She took it gently before gobbling it down.
Maybe you should give her yours. It's not fit to eat,
Red said softly,
without looking at the magistrate. Rivka started to laugh.
At least we know you have a soul.
I know, I'm a big softy. Slavers, I need to keep up my strength. If I know anything about Magistrate Rivka Anoa and her missions, the bad guys are going to be begging for buttermilk before this is all over.
Rivka pointed at Red and then Lindy.
Did you guys get married?
Red coughed until Lindy pounded on his back.
What makes you say that?
You act like you're married. You know, you're doing all the talking and Lindy can't get a word in edgewise.
Red turned to Lindy and she nodded.
So you are married?
Rivka clarified.
No,
Lindy replied when Red threw his hands up in surrender.
We have reservations for next week, so if we don't make it back, the station administrator will scratch us off the list. We'll just keep the honeymoon going for that much longer.
That's my girl,
Red said proudly. She stabbed a finger into his chest.
That's my big husky hunk of man candy.
You two were made for each other. Rivka mumbled as she grabbed two slices and headed for the bridge.
Chaz, we got work to do.
We got work to do,
Floyd cried happily.
Yes, we do, little girl. We'll see if you can come, but if you can't, don't be sad.
We're making the universe a safer place for people like you, Jay explained. Hamlet picked that moment to make his appearance. He vaulted onto the table where the food was, draping himself across the middle and grooming his face.
Get down.
Red reached down to swat the cat, earning himself a long streak of parallel scratches.
Who put the cat in the pod, Doc?
Maybe he's naturally faster than you?
Jay asked. She reached up and scratched his chin and he stretched lazily, exposing his soft belly fur. She scratched him quickly until he curled around her hand and tried to bite a finger. She pulled her hand away so quickly that his jaws snapped shut on air, his claws exposed on all four paws.
Amazeballs,
Red remarked. Lindy looked at the empty place where Jay's hand used to be. Hamlet started licking himself, as if nothing had happened. The Corranite reached through the bars and yanked the human woman to her feet. The bruise on her cheek extended to her now swollen shut eye. He wasn't pleased. She blinked at him with her good eye and ripped at his arm with her bare hands.
You'll go for a good price as soon as your face returns to normal.
He grunted and pulled her head closer to his. She snorted and spat, and the Corranite laughed heartily.
Ha! Is that all you have?
Her look of triumph turned to fear, as he called on every fiber of his being to bring up a great ball of phlegm. She fought against his grip, but he was too strong. When he unloaded on her, it was like getting hit in the face by an egg from a 50-kilo grasshawk. She gagged and puked. Yellow bile dripped from her lips, a testament to the time that had passed since she'd last eaten. She scrubbed the disgusting stuff from her face and flung it on his leg.
I'm going to get a rag and ice. You're going to clean up and then put ice on that bruise. Next time I may not be so kind.
He released her head and pushed her away, not hard enough to knock her down, but hard enough to remind her who was in charge. She glared at him from one eye. He walked away without further posturing. The woman sighed heavily once he was gone and scrubbed at her face to remove his filth. Ice? To draw a higher price? She didn't think so.
Sequa, what have you gotten yourself into?
The woman asked. An exclusive party with rich guys, but she was with her friends. Her so-called friends. None of them seemed to be in the cages. She remembered dancing under a rainbow strobe. And the next thing she knew, she woke up in a slave pen.
I didn't do a damn thing. Those fuckers can stand the fuck by. I'm getting out of here and then I'm coming for them. Kidnap me, will you? Fuck all y'all,
she bellowed.
Ice my eye. How about you don't hit me, motherfucker?
Her knuckles turned white as she clenched her fists in anticipation
of the Corranites return. Peacekeepers sat serenely at the heliosphere's edge, little more than a hole in space. Corran was three planets away, second from the system's star. Three tiny moons orbited in fast ellipses, their pull on the planet's surface minimal. Traffic control worked around the moons to keep unsuspecting ships from powering down at a geosynchronous location, only to find themselves in the path of a mindless and merciless chunk of rock. Orbits well beyond the planet's gravity were safe, and it required the utmost coordination to keep ships from competing with each other for the few open flight windows. There seemed to be more ships than opportunities to reach the planet's surface. Flight control struggled to maintain order.
"That's a real shit show down there,"
Red offered. Chaz was piping the feed to the rec room, as well as the bridge. Rivka half listened. She was neck deep in reading legal treatises, and her eyes were bloodshot from perusing the mountain of words.
"How do you think we'll get to the planet?"
Lindy asked.
"Hitch a ride?"
Red put one finger on the back of his hand as he made it fly through the air and land on the table.
"Wouldn't be the first time."
"We might get shot for pulling rank to get a slot in an open window."
"We might get shot anyway. Our luck isn't good when it comes to not getting shot at."
"Maybe it's a gift?"
Lindy smiled and tilted her head. Red stared.
"What?"
"Sometimes I need to remind myself not to take my best friend for granted. I look at every mission."
"Case!"
Rivka yelled through the bridge's open hatch.
"As if we're going into combat. Even on the station, I can't relax and think of a time when people won't shoot at the magistrate. They're afraid of her, as well they should be. And I think of my partner, and how we can tactically deploy to do our jobs. But I also feel compelled to protect you. I know that's not what you want or need, and I love not having to worry about that. I also love that you have my back. And what started this whole thing was, I love seeing you smile."
"My schmoopy bodyguard,"
Rivka shouted. Red scowled. Lindy smiled, showing the tip of her tongue between her teeth. He relented and smiled back.
"I'm in the right place, doing what I was meant to do. We're going to locate some slavers, and then we're going to ruin their day. Hopefully they will give us a good reason and the magistrate leaves something for us."
Lindy hesitated, and her eyes started to glisten. She blinked quickly.
"I love you, Varid. It's a schmoop fest."
Rivka was standing in the hatch and slowly clapping.
"What the hell? Don't you have homework or something?"
Red was torn between looking at Rivka and trying to make time with his partner.
"I'm done with what I need to do. We need to talk about how we're going to peel this onion. Can you get Ankh, please?"
Red ran a hand down Lindy's arm and it somehow found its way to her backside, which he cupped appreciatively.
"Our wedding vows should probably include I promise to grab your butt every day. Because it's going to happen, isn't it?"
"Probably,"
Red said, before letting go and taking the few steps to the stateroom that Ankh had designated as his workshop.
"Come on, big man. Team meeting."
Ankh strolled out, holding his hands over his ears. His night vision goggles had become a permanent fixture on his forehead, and they faced Red like an extra set of eyes.
"Next time, warn me before you show up at my door and do your impression of a dying Bistock."
Red cupped his hands around his mouth and started bellowing, and Lindy jabbed him in the ribs.
"What the god-awful noise is that?"
"A dying Bistock."
Red looked for support from the crew. Only contorted faces looked back at him.
"I hope I never hear that sound again," Jay stated.
"Seconded," Rivka declared. "Fine."
Red worked his way into the small kitchen area, tapped the food processor screen, and waited until a bar popped out.
"Didn't you just eat?" Lindy asked.
"That was a couple hundred light years ago,"
Red replied before taking a bite.
"Point to Red."
Rivka motioned with one finger in the air, marking a single digit in her bodyguard's favor. Her face turned solemn as she started to brief her team.
The slave trade is highly regulated on Corran. Each sentient being who is to be sold has to undergo medical and psychological evaluations. To the untrained eye, it appears to be a cooperative and mutually beneficial system.
Unless you're the slave, Jay said softly.
Exactly. They rarely disqualify a being from the auction block, but when it happens, they simply go to a different block and are sold as defective merchandise. So, no change for the victims. We are here to find those who are bringing illegal captives to Corran. Once they are introduced into the system, our access to information becomes non-existent. Corran is not a Federation signatory. They don't even owe us the courtesy of allowing us to land. But Reynolds is in negotiations for them to accommodate this request. They know that if they join the Federation, their slave trade will instantly become illegal. There can be no casual phase-out of such a practice.
Accessing their systems will not be a problem,
Ankh said in his small voice.
How far are we willing to push?
Not being seen is better than pulling every byte from their storage systems. They cannot know it was us digging behind the curtain.
So we can't push too hard, but I expect to find every byte and bit of data you need without leaving a trace. I can do it from here. I prefer not to leave the ship.
We'll drop your devices wherever you need us to,
Red said, giving the Krennelian a thumbs up.
Ankh's face remained unreadable as he looked up at the oversized human.
You keep Floyd company.
Jay minced no words. Ankh turned his head and glanced at her but didn't say anything. The wombat tottered to him and nuzzled his arm. Jay pointed at him.
Pet her.
Ankh mechanically stroked the fur on her head.
Don't you feel better and happier?
Jay asked with a smile.
No,
Ankh replied simply. But he didn't stop petting Floyd.
We will go to the main slave market, and from there work our way up until we meet with the Governor General.
Rivka noted the distaste on the faces of her team.
It's as fun as watching child porn to build a case against a scumbag.
Have you had to do that?
Lindy wondered. Thank the gods, no. But it wouldn't get that far. I'd look into his mind and know in an instant which way he needed to die.
I think you're serious,
Red said. Rivka raised one eyebrow.
You're going to see some horrible shit from these people. How can we help keep you sane?
That could be the best question you've ever asked, Red.
How indeed. I think the best thing is to not touch anyone who might not be involved in the illegal stuff. So the initial plan is to not touch anyone with my bare hands. Run blocker for me so no one gets too close.
Done,
Red and Lindy declared together.
Jay, I need you to stay strong. This is the twilight of the slave trade. If Lance Reynolds is successful at bringing this planet into the Federation, the very last of the legal slave planets will be gone. We will break out the brooms and sweep the bad guys into the dustbins of history. We know there will be some who think themselves superior and won't let go. We'll fix them when the time is right. But for now, non-Corranites can get licensed to transport captured sentient cargo. With a license, they are protected inside this system. Regardless, some species are illegal to be slaves. Yolans are on that list, and so are humans. If we find one of those, we can request an immediate release.
I sense a but coming,
Red interrupted.
But, Rivka continued, we have to get the release before we can detain the slaver and free the victim.
Does that go for anyone who deserves to be freed?
They all deserve to be set free, but no. Only those on the sanctioned list are eligible to get a release.
Ankh, Lindy, Red, and Jay shared looks. Ankh closed his eyes and three data pads buzzed.
You guys aren't betting again, are you?
Rivka asked.
Chapter 3. We have been granted a priority clearance, Chaz relayed.
The ship maneuvered between heavy haulers, freighters,
yachts, and passenger ships.
You're going to get us killed, Chaz,
Red exclaimed.
Why don't you hail one of the freighters that's only carrying cargo? We can piggyback and move them to the front of the line. Then we'll have one friend at least.
Traffic control has not approved that plan, the ship's AI warned.
We'll squawk our beacon. They won't know the difference, Rivka shrugged.
They won't know the difference between a corvette and a freighter ripping through their atmosphere,
Chaz grumbled. Was he nicer when he was less evolved? Jay asked.
Much nicer, Lindy replied. The Tombo Queen is pleased with your proposal and accepts your offer. They are moving out of line to meet us.
A massive ship lumbered through space. A yacht tried to hold its ground, but soon realized that the freighter was coming, regardless of their presence. They darted aside at the last instant, clearing the way for the queen. Chaz expertly maneuvered.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.